this exuberantly magnificent creation of the Almighty, we have been given all resources. There are raw materials, which are known as fundamental resources. Then there are innumerable derivatives. Then we have subtle resources like the power of intellect, the power of mental sturdity and commitment. And we have even transcendental resources in the form of spiritual prowess. So these three types of resources, which we call outer resources, and innermost resources. These resources, they must be identified and organized in a systematic manner, which we call it as governance. Either it may be organizing one's own resources, which is self-governance, or it may be for a collective community who is helpless, and people who are upcoming, and people who are well organized. So in a society which has a medley of varieties of members in different standards of comprehensibility, adaptability and capability, to organize them properly, that is what we call governance. So governance is a process of identification, exploration, processing or administration, distribution or sustainability or augmentation of those resources. This is the science of governance. And these processes are the proper way of handling these sources, as the human mind is ambivalent, as the human mind is capricious and flexible to any type of circumstantial impact and their consequential abnormities, it is the duty also for us to organize the mind to be free from the imbalance equilibrium, as well as to see that the impact does not permeate the society. So it has resulted in the formation of contributive and retributive organizations. The contributive is the forms of the various skills of management of resources which I have quoted now, and retributive to bring control in the society in their mental equilibrium, always to take the measures of preventive, investigative and punitive variations. There are different types of such things in the society which we know in the form of the investigation authorities are there, then the judiciary mechanism is there. So all of these people, they take care of this preventive, investigative and punitive areas. So this is what we call as governance. And now we have to define good governance. We have been put in such a deplorable status that we have to prefix good to everything. If there is a doctor, then his professional standard, that implies the person's caliber, capability, commitment, compassion, everything. Each and everybody's professional standard is inclusive of his ethical stability. So now we are being put in such a despicable status that we have to say that he is a good doctor, he is a good teacher, good student. So due to the various reflections of imbalances in their caliber or in their ethical morale, it has been put to such a downtrend status that it must be addressed with the prefix good. So governance itself includes all the essential characteristics for unit leadership, control and administration, which does not require any prefix known as good. But not taking into the phenomenal scrutiny, taking into the current affairs and the contemporary situations, we have to define things, not as per the books or the scriptures. So contemporary, practically, whatever is there in the palpable environment, we have to certainly distinguish the so-called government in the scriptures or the so-called government to which we are the subjects, as well as the real ways of bringing back the real glory and valor of the government. So that we have been put in such a position. That I want to address, that good governance must have three qualities. One is prudence. A person to govern himself, he must possess prudence. Then prudence assisted with capability is real power. If a person is very prudent without executive skill, then that is useless. If a person is prudent and capable, but not being honest, the person is totally useless to society and it is going to result in adversity. So a person having viveka, sagacity or prudence, capability, samarthya, and arjava, which is honesty, all these three qualities are there, which forms the basic substratum of good governance. If a person is prudent, then his governance will be perpetual. It will have a perennial shower of resources and compatibility to the society. If the same person is capable, then he can execute the things with promptitude. Then only he can do things with promptitude and productivity. If he is honest, then only he can maintain equality in the society in the distribution of resources. So these three qualities are the vertebral column of the real good governance. Apart from that, we have to deal with the different types of good governance. One, absolute good governance. As it has been told in Srimad Ramayana, absolute good governance, where there is nobody to beg, nobody to steal, or nobody to ask. It may be always discouraged as an utopian conception or conceptualization. It is not absolute. Second thing is a majority good governance, in which there are some negligible infinitesimal creatures which are crawling with their unethical practices and conceptions, but the majority is ruled by good people. The third thing is dominant good governance, in which there is a quantitative limitation, but qualitatively those people handle the power and they organize the society. There are three types of good governance. And as per the spatial classification, there is self-governance, there is a provincial governance, there is a national governance, and there is a global governance. So everything starts with self-governance. If a person having the power properly organizes himself, then he can organize the whole society. Such people, they are known as benevolent dictators. We see lot of dictatorial democrats, and we have read also about so many benevolent dictators like Sri Rama, King Solomon, everybody. They were dictators, but they were benevolent. The single person, he is well organized. So even though he dictates everybody, the dictatorship was as benevolent or comparatively more benevolent than that of the real God's rule, or the real rule of wisdom, real rule of mercy, real rule of absolute prosperity. So these type of systems, self means that we have different dimensions of the self. One is our emotional and sensational status as a bulk of biological and psychological instincts and emotions. And second thing is our academic status, our family status, and professional status. These things come under self-governance. They are properly, because we have seen in lot of the people, those who are ill-organized and unorganized, either misdirection or misguidance or lack of proper care and control in their family, academic, and professional standards, that things have led the persons to go into turmoil, also leading the other persons to the same zone. So self-governance where it is unethical, that reflects in persons of high valor and command, that reflects in dictatorship of a country, wars between kingdoms and nations, mass colossal destruction and catastrophe to the world, everything causes from the disordered mechanism of a single mind, which is organized by a group of followers and dependents, everybody, etc. So these people we have to take care by the spiritual wealth. What is the role of these people, the so-called spiritual people, which they have forgotten to organize, which they were inefficiently or insufficiently doing, and what is the role of this transcendental knowledge of our scriptures in playing a significant domain in the reinstallation of an ethical empire in our globe? That is the thing which we are going to discuss. And we clearly know that peace and prosperity, what we call as peace and prosperity, these two things are very much essential for the world. Where does this peace and prosperity come from? Peace is known as inner dynamism. If a person is sitting quietly or taking rest, he is peaceful. That type of inert and imbecile peace is used for nothing. So peace means dynamism. Inner dynamism is known as peace. And environmental dynamism is known as prosperity. So both of the dynamic infusions must result in the totalitarian development or sustainable development of a nation or a globe. For that, what are the hindering factors? There are two hindering factors for these issues. One is desire. Second thing is hatredness. Certainly, a human being who is born, certainly he must like somebody and he must hate somebody. These things are unavoidable. But if they are mistargeted, if they cross beyond the limit, if they are circumstantially irrelevant and destructive, those things will cause a very ineffable turmoil in the society, also resulting in consequential disorders. How it is? Desire means it starts with the desire. Desire, if it is unorganized, it becomes avarice. Avarice tempts the person to go for corruption. Corruption results in compromise of righteousness. Compromise of righteousness results in abnormities, which will result in the totalitarian order of the social morale. So it has connectivity in the society. So hatredness that grows, if it is well nourished and manured, that becomes conflict, then that becomes animosity. If the same person, if he is given some sort of additional resources such as power, seat, designation, weapons, etc., then that will result in a very great destruction in this society. For these things only our Shastra, they are given two instincts. One is Tripti, one is Virakti, contentment and detachment. So detachment and contentment, it need not be attributed to only sannyasins. Tera tyaktena bhunjita. So even the persons who are experiencing these things, the worldly pressures, as it is unavoidable for any human being to be attached with family, resources, necessities, dependabilities, these things are unavoidable. So there are two types of renunciation. One is possessive renunciation, the other thing is abdicative renunciation. In spite of possessing something, this contentment and the second thing, virakti, detachment, these things are the showers of spiritual training and blessing. That is what we are going to teach, and that which has been taught by our forefathers. And the final thing what we want to say is, there are some questions which are there in the minds of people about these systems of good governance. One, is good governance possible? Number two, even if it is possible, is it sustainable? Number three, we are all limited people. You know how many people are here attending and hearing this thing? How many of people they are going to carry in their ears, are carrying in their minds, carrying in their intellect, going to execute in their day-to-day life or to organize the other people to come in this pathway? All of these things are suspicious. So these limited people, where we are going to properly, practically organize or wage a war against this unethical governance system in the society? That is the third question. Fourth thing is, there is a global disorder. Even though if you create good governance in a small province, it will be immediately extinguished because it will be overruled by a major province of disorder which is acting on various corners of the globe. That is the fourth thing. Number fifth, even if you organize good governance, what are the tools and where are the resources? What are the tools and resources? We need a lot of youth. Youth means it does not something physically, we need not unite youth. Youth is the capability, determination and executive dexterity for a person to commit and to create things. So youth is required. What are all the financial resources that are to be organized? And the patronage of knowledgeable persons. How to create a system? So it must become a movement. What is the difference between statement and movement? Statement is what the politicians give for us, and movement is what they take for us and for their development. So they are still developing, and still we are kept under development because of the reason that we are offered only statements, and that development is based on movements. What is movement? That which moves from person to person, place to place, to the deepest abysmal core of a person's heart. So that which moves inside a person, that which moves from person to person, that which is organized from place to place, that is known as movement. So great political movements, freedom struggle movements, and revolutionary organizations are any type of thing that is existing and that is flourishing is on based of only movements, not statements. Whatever I speak and whatever we organize in the form of these symposia, workshops and conferences, these things are statements. It must be well organized under a unique leadership where the person radiates with the beam of his transcendental austerity, penance and outputs of his spiritual realization, by which a committed group is organized, who is taking a routinal and sincere way of execution of whatever that has been implanted by their preceptors. So that must be taken as a movement. And who is going to sponsor all of these things? Then the sixth is, what is the primary requisite? It is known as sacrifice. Everybody must understand that sacrifice is the base for good governance. Who is going to sacrifice? Everybody is interested in procuring something and also preserving the thing that they have procured. Yoga, Kshema, they are interested in most of these things. Who is interested in Tyaga? Because what is the output of tyaga? In the divine realm, if you sacrifice, you will get ineffable bliss, eudaimonia, nityananda, brahmananda. In the world, the fruits of tyaga is threat, torture and turmoil. If you sacrifice everything, or if you want good governance or honesty, you will be put under threat or under torture, or your total address will be removed from the global directory. This is the effect. Who will be interested in self-immolation? Nobody will be interested. So that sacrifice is there in the society, but misplaced. There are a lot of people who sacrifice their hair locks to the deities of Tirumala, etc. Lot of people are doing a lot of sacrifices in rituals, and there are a lot of committed people who are sacrificing their whole life for their silver screen idols and political idols. We see a lot of sacrifices in the society, misplaced and malevolent sacrifices we see in the society. So in the sacrifice, number one, everybody will be afraid of sacrifice, because that is an art of losing something. Where you gain pleasure by loss is known as sacrifice. Define sacrifice. Sacrifice comes out of a great person where he leaves something greater for a greatest common attribute or a purpose. So it is done by a great person, and the thing that is left or renounced must be greater, and the purpose or the cause must be the greatest. Then only it becomes a sacrifice. Other than the share market, other things, that is not sacrifice, that is loss. So intentional abdication of a greater thing for the greatest thing is known as sacrifice. So that creates fear in the society. Only our country has been constructed only by people of sacrifice. Now we are all the beneficiaries of the society. Real benefactors of the society, they had only sacrifice. Sacrifice and nothing else than that. But that is a benevolent, committed, potential sacrifice with power. Sacrifice due to imbecilism, that is not sacrifice. Sacrifice with the strength. So that creates two things. One, fear in the society. And moreover, if a really good person sacrifices himself, that is a loss to the globe also. We are losing such a person by sacrifice. But the Shastra says that whenever a real person in sacrifice, he sacrifices himself, there emerges hundreds of persons from the thought. Each and every thought atom, each and every commitment atom of the person, even more than that of his presence, his departure radiates the society, and there emerges lot of people committing sacrifice, which we have seen in the Indian freedom struggle and other establishments of the universal empires. We are seeing those things where eradication of the unethical practices were done, and also installation of a nobility and morale has been done. In all these historical episodes, we are seeing such people. So this is the sacrifice. So these questions are very much common in the society. Now we must always consider the challenges. We used to say in business administration, one is success scrutiny, second is failure investigation. Read about the success and try to adopt the same measures if they are adaptable and relevant to our circumstances. Second thing is failure investigation. It may be the failure of the other sets or failure of our own organization, and we have to read a lot from success and failure. Likewise, what are the challenges before us for good governance? One is terrorism. Terrorism, there are, we used to say two things. The youth or the organized potential of the society has been totally uncared by the rulers, who are interested in enthronement, rethronement and thronement of their accessories and dependents. So they were continuously engaged in the process of getting power and preserving their power, and also to organize the power for their lineage. So they were totally uncaring these people, who went into two areas. One is destructive area and second is non-productive area. This non-productive people went into aberration, alcoholism, immoral trafficking, drug addiction, unemployment. This is the unorganized and non-productive members of the society. Then the destructive members of the society in terrorism. I used to say misplaced patriotism is terrorism. Whatever the qualities of patriotism is there, everything is there, but misplaced in terrorism. And also in one seminar of terrorism, I quoted one thing which was applauded by many of the participants, where I told that if two people sit and work for something constructive, there will be two problems. They will meet only intermittently. There won't be any frequent discussions. Number two, when they talk about such issues, it will come to you and me, ego clash, and they won't talk about the project and its productivity. But whenever two terrorists talk to their association will be incessant. Frequently they will be in contact, mail, mobile phone, direct meeting, everything will be there. Second thing, If both of them communicate, they will think only about the destruction, not about their ego clash. But these constructive personalities and participants, they will discuss only about themselves, not about the construction. This is a real problem. So I used to say that terrorism has all absolute. Anavadhika, Atishya, Sankheya, Kalyana, Gunagana. All of these gunas are there. But that is misplaced for a destructive purpose. And who is the real person? The causative factor behind that. It is only the organizing system. And we are also sharing the sin because we have invited them to organize. We have not done that. The mass society, they have elected that person. You have to teach the mass society, you have not done that. So you are enjoying the associative benefit of it. So this is how we have to classify on a prudential and logical, strategical, analytical study of the society. Then apart from these various things, terrorism I have already explained, then aberration I have explained, then there are two disasters. One is a natural disaster. Natural disaster by means of explosion, like oceanic explosion, oceanic quake, earthquake. Then we have the explosion in the form of volcanic eruptions, etc. Then collisions of meteors, comets and other astro bodies are there. Then there is also depletion of natural resources. What are the natural resources? It is not something connected with mineralogy or mineology or material science. Even with water, even with good air, even at Bangalore, Mumbai and other places, they are selling oxygen. There are oxygen clubs. They are like cyber cafe, they are having oxygen cafe now. It is there in the society and no doubt it is going to flourish. So what is the use of you developing yourself, spoiling the whole earth? That's why even construction technology conference we addressed, and the epilogue was like this. You have beautified your houses and huge constructions have been made in infrastructure management, but you have spoiled the beauty of the earth. That is what we concluded. Likewise, what is there? Everything has been put into depletion. So good governance not only includes all of these things, certainly, it includes lot of things like defense, national security, health and hygiene, education and employment, social welfare, upliftment of the downtrodden people, then finance, commerce and trade, international relations, policy relations, then border dispute resolutions, then international relations with the peace and harmony, and interreligious harmony within the society. So there are innumerable areas which must be governed by people, and each and every citizen must be turbulent and vigilant. Turbulent and vigilant. Citizens are the assets of the society. All the other people, I used to say that there are two types of citizens in India. One is asset citizen, second is in Tamil, asset citizen. Likewise, this type of asset citizens, they are going to contribute, just as I have already told in one seminar, that we cannot include in an educational area, for us, in an example, we can just call it as a school or college or university. We cannot include the lizards, cockroaches and the crows in the academic campus, in the students register. Likewise, the unconcerned people are the deviated people, are the somnolent and stagnant members of the society. They must not be included as citizens at all. Only those who are vigilant, turbulence, they have to be designated as the citizens of the country, and which even in a defense seminar we addressed that a non-vigilant, uncommitted citizen is 100 times dangerous to the nation than a sworn enemy across the border. So this is how we have to understand the management all of the resources, management of all of the resources, and the explosion as well as collision and depletion in the natural disasters. They must be also read, and what is the use of understanding these things and what is the role of spirituality, I am going to state now. And the second thing is, apart from the natural disaster, as if the natural disasters are very limited and insufficient, we have created some technological disasters, man-made disasters. Mass destruction weapons are there, biological weapons, chemical weapons, then radiological weapons, we have created lot of weapons like that. Like that, lot of weapons are created, which I addressed in one seminar on disarmament, that the worst and dangerous weapon is the mind of a corrupted person which has created all of these weapons. So one who has designed that, one who has made that, one who has preserved that, one who is applying that, the mind, their mind is the worst weapon than the weapon itself. So all of these disasters are there in the society due to the imbalance of the mental equilibrium. Unless that thing is governed, how it can be governed? By education, by ethical implantation, by spiritual training, or by controlling the person by punishments through proper judicial touch. the person must be totally trampled under the powerful clutches of judiciary. So this is how we have to read all of these things. Then we have to deal with the global constant and ethical implantation phenomenon. What is that? See, we must understand something. Global constant, the more it is known as elasticity, the more your population is there, your necessity, emergency and demands are there, the elasticity of the resources will also maintain as per your requirement. It is a God-given gift. There is no insufficiency in God's creation. Sarvam Purnam Sahom. Everything is full. And whenever that is exploited or misorganized or misappropriated by a group of people who are leeching the other community, the poor or the weaker sections of the community, then only this mechanism is disturbed. So if ethical implantation is there, natural mechanism of global constant and elasticity of resources as per the demand necessity of the growing population can be done. That is the greatness of only the spiritual knowledge and spiritual practice. It cannot be identified by a scientific community or by any innovative mechanism. It is something there like that. Apart from that, we want to say, what is the basic science and technology? That which upgrades the persons, those who are going to invent, those who are going to operate, those who are going to benefit, that is known as real science and technology. I have upgraded my AK-47. I have uploaded and upgraded my AK-47. But before deriving such a mechanism, which is both meant for security as well as self-defense or national defense, as well as for destruction, it is ambivalent. So while making such mechanisms, we must not only upgrade this mechanism, but also the rudimentary mechanism which lies in the minds of the person, those who have found it, and the persons, those who are going to use it, that is the creators and the consumers, as well as the mediators or the organizers, either it may be a state reactor or a non-state reactor, their minds must be organized. And that is not there in science. No science that teaches you nuclear science, nuclear physics, it does not teach you. It can teach you that it is destructive as well as it is productive. But it cannot teach you how to implant that ethical morale inside your mind so that you can only for productivity. The type of governing your mind or organizing you to govern your mind is only there in religio-ethical training, not in scientific training. So real science and technology is that which shapes, channelizes, nourishes, vitalizes the minds of the people, those who are creating and contributing and distributing, not merely unilateral upgradation of the elements alone, totally putting the other end into a non-positive or a destructive area. So that type of scientific development is a disaster to the society. And the third thing is, we have to now understand the current socio-economical and political conditions of our country. Without understanding the current situations, we cannot establish any good governance. Establishing good governance is not uniform. It varies from each and every country because of the system of government, the mental setup of the people, the environment of the area, as well as the other factors of influence that will differ from each and the other country. So unless the country's socio-economical and political factors are identified, amongst the three, the political factor is determined by the society and anyonashaya. And the society is once again that is influenced by the political factors. So this only determines the economics also. So this political system and a politically dependent economical and social system must be well understood. Political system, I have already told, it is power. So just as it has been told that power means corruption. If power is given in the hands of an unorganized person, then immediately you will be interested in self-development or trampling on the heads of the others. It is so, because it is abuse of power. Whenever power is given to a person who has not organized himself, then that will cause either benefit to the person or harm to the concerned other members of the society. It is there. So this political system, now the existing system, is based on a different mechanism, different type of mechanism, very whimsical mechanism. The government is having two major weapons. One is a diversion. Whenever you raise something which is essential for the society, immediately the society will be diverted. Once there was a strong protest from all villages that they are in need of the basic requirements like road, water, etc. Immediately the government supplied TVs. At that time these channels were immediately each and every village was supplied TVs. Then you must believe me that for more than 5 to 6 years nobody opened their mouth except for eating. Nobody opened their mouth. So it is known as diversion. The government knows the mentality of the people. And diversion is the first tool. and second tool is projection. Whenever something wrong is there, it will either self-stage, it will self-organize some good deeds, or already as a government it has to do something good to the society, unavoidably, unintentionally. Those things will be projected and other things will be curtailed. So this is an art of fabrication. And number two, the society is having three types of members. One is the negligent member. Negligent member of the society, whatever it is there, I am having food and I am sufficient. Second, subservient member. The government is like that. Unless I travel in the same way, unless I travel in the same coach and boat, I cannot have a good comfortable travel. So let me be submissive to them and enjoy the food. That is subservient people. Third thing is initiate. They don't know anything about the society at all. Whatever that has been projected to them, whatever that is projected by media or projected by the hearsay stories of the other members, that is what they know. They are very much unconcerned about the society because of nations. So nations, subservience and negligence that rules the society. And moreover, there are two things. One is sense, second is sensation. Sense is something which has some practical usage. For example, water, education, agricultural development, these things are sensible, something having sense. Caste, religion, language, border, all of these things are sensational. The government that is just observing the society's sensational reflection and adaptability, then by provoking these sensational instincts, that governs more with sensations rather than with senses. And moreover, power that gives all pressures. Power gives command. Power gives luxury. It gives respect. If you are there well established in power, then you will get perennial power. Even though you are out of power, you will be well established. That is known as safety zone. You will be in a safety zone so that even if you are out of power, you can have a command, you can have influence, you can have a good settlement for your forthcoming generations. That will be there. So there are three types of people in this power. Those who are in the throne of power, those who are tasting the power, those who are in the hope of tasting power. So these three members of the society are there. And their dependents are there, and their well-wishers and their patrons are there. All of these people will come to, there is an approximate statistical report that in India there will be just 1 lakh members. Those who are in the throne, those who are tasting the power as a subordinate, and those who are in the hope, they are adhering to some persons in the hope of getting some power, and their dependents and their promoters or patrons as well as their well-wishers, it will just be 1 lakh. So it is just 10,000 is to 1 in the society. So because of the unorganized nature of the majority of the society, a small group of people, they are developing. And they are becoming richer than richest, making you poor, poorer and poorest. So this is the real status of the society in understanding this thing. Especially in all areas. Generally we used to say, everybody having power will harass the person who subordinates and necessarily be as a professional obedience, they have to salute to their superordinates. If a person is having a power, they have to do as a mark of obedience to their superordinates, and they have to harass the persons who are their subordinates or the weaklings, each and everybody. And one policeman, he told, it must be well known to those people, those who are experienced in that industry. So we have no practical, but we have experience in the form of self-subjection. We don't know professional practice. But still one person told, he is from a very great police standard, he told, if a police person is not doing any harm or abusing his power, then he must be either a resigned police or retired police or a traffic police. So this is how the society is. Then the final thing I come to the conclusion. What is the role of India in bringing good governance? There are two types of things. Bringing through Indian traditional knowledge and practices good governance to India, and also showing as a torchbearer of the global community, the leader, wisdom leader of the global community, what is the knowledge system that India is going to organize for the other nations to establish good governance? What is India's salient feature or distinguishable feature in that? You know that India is a land of a different type of glory. Apart from the intellectual pursuit, apart from science and our so-called the innovative technologies, we have the innermost resources. It is a land of the seers. So what we are going to organize for this society, there are few points. Number one, everybody believes that there will be a savior or group of saviors. Abhyuttanam adharmasya tadatmanam sujamyaham tada atmanam sujamyaham. I am coming. I am dissenting. Jnani tu atma. He says that Jnani is my atma. So I am also not only coming to the world, I am also sending my delegates. So whenever there is a turmoil, at the time of emergency, at the time of absolute and indispensable necessity in the society, at the time of the integral protest or demand from the good members of the society, then God descends or sends his delegates. That is the real thing. So there will be a savior. He may be a revolutionary spirit, just as the communism they says, that there must be a revolutionary spirit, or it may be a reverential spirit also. Somebody will come as the savior. So we have to pray that a group of people are already available people, they must be integrated, number one. And the persons who are about to come are about to manifest themselves, they have to come, and they must be led by the divine spirit or the divine activation. So that is the first thing. That is, we are going to get an organized system. If we really pray and organize ourselves, we will get all essential resources from internal intellectual support, spiritual support, just as we used to call it as moral courage. If we want to do something, we must have that moral courage that we are going to discuss in the second point, which is not a spiritual training. Sir, I am honest. I am working for this reasonable, good or honest governance. I am having two difficulties. Number one, even if I am really good, if I am put amidst unorganized people or those people who are in malice, within a malicious community, I cannot execute my honesty. So there are possibilities that I may be infused by them. I may be influenced by them. So then we must have sankalpa, abhyasa, vairagya, by practice and determination. So if you think that your determination to form a self-governance, good governance, if it will be disturbed by the majority of the malicious community, you must develop determination. Second thing is rakshana, that is protection. If you are determined to be good, then you will be totally destroyed by the other evil forces, because they cannot survive with these people. So whenever some medicine enters inside, then immediately there will be a battle between our inner resistance and the malarial germs. So there will be a combat between the remedial and malarial ingredients. Likewise, whenever a person is determined to be good, immediately the evil forces will go against them. Then he needs protection. So unless a person practices the spiritual methodologies by which he can get both the things, one is determination to be self-determined. Second thing is protection, to have a shield or armor against the evil forces. Then the third thing is, there is a question, why can't I enter into an ethical training? Why I must go for religion or God? I can practice honesty without the address of God. Then we tell that you must always affix yourself with a supernatural and super potential force, thinking that I can do and I will do. No doubt for execution, this type of self-confidence is very much essential, and it gives the base for the success of each and every person. Self-confidence between two persons I am going to distinguish. One, a person who is having confidence on his own self. Second, a person who is having confidence on the universal self which is manifesting inside him. So self-confidence deals with both individual and universal self. If you think that God is an embodiment of honesty, and through his connectivity I am charged with honesty, and also the determination to be honest and to be protected against dishonest persons and their influences, then I'll get more power. So this is connectivity between an impotential or an infrapotential spirit with the superpotential spirit. That is very much essential. Then there are four things: presence, participation, patronage and prayer. How much we can be present at Jammu Kashmir or Ethiopia or Somalia, we cannot be there. How much we can participate, how much we can patronize, but we can pray. The prayer has got more powers. So this is the fourth thing. Fifth thing is, the society has one major clash, known as ego clash, I have already told. This ego clash only results in disharmony. This can be removed only by realization between wife and husband, between children and parents, between a preceptor and his disciple, between nations, between subordinates and superordinates. Wherever we see, there is a friction. And this thing can be removed only by a balanced mind, which requires the connectivity between the supreme and individual, without which it cannot be achieved, it cannot be sustainably achieved, it cannot be permanently achieved. So it is very much essential. Then second thing is applied philosophy. It is very much important. What is the difference between philosophy and applied philosophy? I asked him to define philosophy. He told, number one, whatever that you do, God will excuse. Whatever the evil activities that you have done, God will excuse. That is a pardon. then you are not doing anything. The karma is forcing you to do something. So it is an excuse. So this type of justification or shelter for our sins and their consequential dangers, as well as it is also becoming a reservoir which supplies all our necessities. So God has become a supplier of our necessities and shelter for our sins as well as their consequential problems. So it is not like that. Applied philosophy says that the remedies are meant for purification of your own self. Repension, rectification and reinstallation of your morale is the purpose of the remedies in Shastras. So applied philosophy, it gives you three benefits. It has two major forces giving you three benefits. You have to note down this. Number one, if your person is hard like a rock without mercy, it will make him a molten wax. It will create, instill in him mercy. At the same time, if the people are weaklings, if the people are totally impotent, it will make them like a rock to fight against evil. And it will give you the type of ambidexterity of executing the status of being wax for God, devotees, divinity, nobility, etc. At the same time, you will be a rock when you are in a battle against morality in the world. So the spirituality, especially in applied philosophy, wherever we are seeing the spiritual people crying or dancing or sitting in inertia, we have seen only one dimension of it. The other dimension is very powerful. It is powerful than thousands and millions of hydrogen bombs and atomic explosions. That type of the real explosive prowess of our spiritual energy or zeal, that must be organized only by spiritual leaders. So it is very much essential. It is what we call the ambidexterity of a person who is in spiritual realization or spiritual attainment. Then apart from that, there are three lineages. Somebody asked, why we are suffering? We have a lot of scripture. There are three lineages. One is a conceptive lineage. Second thing is initiative lineage. In informative lineage, we are there. We have a lot of books like Shrutis, Smritis, Shastras, Sutras, Bhashya, Vyakshana, Tika, Tippani, Vada. We have a lot of other granthas. That is our informative lineage. But whereas in implementing lineage and initiative lineage, we don't have proper system. Uninterrupted disciplinic and disciplinic section was not there. Avichinna Guru Parampara Prapta is there for the informative lineage. At the same time, the informations are there in the form of books, Satya, Mada, Dharma, Chara. These things are available. But where is the lineage, unbreakable, uninterrupted lineage of implementing these informations or initiating these informations in the Guru Shishya Parampara? That is not there. So our loss is due to the lack of the other two lineages. That is very much important. Now in this group, we have discussed to start one movement. The book is just, it has been released for giving an idea and awareness in the society. Already it is known, it is a reminder. We used to say, smaraye natu shikshaye. We cannot say that nobody knows about good governance. Everybody knows about honesty. Dishonest people more knows about honesty than real honest people. Everybody will know about these things. It does not mean that we are going to teach something new, but we are going to them. We are putting it in an organized manner with the theme, the consequences, the present society, what must be done, what are the ill effects. So we are putting it in a logistic, strategical, statistical and logical presentation is given as a reminder. That is what we are going to do now. So we are now starting a ritual for social renaissance, RSR. Today we have started the ritual for social renaissance. And our land is very glorious for three reasons. It is the land for ritualizations. It is the land for ritualization, tyaga. With devata uddesha, whatever the dravya tyaga we do, that is known as ekita vidhiyate. So this is the land of ritualization. It is the land of renunciation. It is the land of realization. It is we who first administered the global village concept, vasudhaiva kutumbakam. So no doubt we have to initiate that, and we have to first take care of our country, then we can go for the other countries, then becoming a margadarshaka for the other planets even later. First we have to organize within ourselves. Let me come to the good governance of this program. It has not been well organized, it is clearly known. Because organizing a program is no doubt in an inceptive step. It will be like this. There are a lot of programs in which the walls, ceilings and floors, they have adorned the status of listeners, and we are having at least hundreds of people, more than that. But still it must reach the targeted audience, And we already told that it is a movement, it will move. In the same hall, several uncovered, unexplored dimensions will be scrutinized and they will be manifested, and it will move from this place to various places, and each and every listener can become a speaker by proper realization and understanding, and they can execute this idea to their areas within their inner and outer and innermost surfaces. They can throng upon these things and realize something and do for the betterment of the world. So it is just a starting point. The problem is, what is my role in good governance? Number two, even if it is as an individual, what I am going to do? Third thing, even if I can do, what I am going to immediately do? So if it is for the transition of Saturn from one place to another in a zodiac, you can see thousands of people standing without having proper place in the auditorium. If it is something astrological, or if it is something connected with some ritual or some other festival, they have been very much accommodated with, accustomed, acclimatized and accommodated with such type of practices. And knowledge oriented marketing or knowledge search, knowledge scrutiny, knowledge adaptation, this knowledge reservoir type of programs are not very much accepted in the society. Still, by means of repetitive process of organizing such things in schools, because in academics we have to start it from the impressionable age of youngsters, and we have to take it to the minds of the forthcoming rulers, the younger generation. They are going to the pillars of modern India. We have to take these things to the various places and bless that this function, it is not a function, it is a vision, and it must be taken as a vision. I hope that this will come to infallible success, because it is the role of God and rule of God, and certainly you will achieve it. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.